morning.
The Lord be with you.
Welcome. My name is Stephen Sanders. I'm one of the pastors at Oak Hill United Methodist Church. This morning, I, along with Pastor Laura Adam and our musicians, we are leading in worship on this beautiful day. Today is Father's Day. So for those of us who are fathers, I extend to you a happy Father's Day. For those of us who have fathers, whether they are living or have died, I lift them before you. And as part of worship today, we're going to recognize fathers in our lives and pray God's blessing for them. As we gather here today in the sanctuary and as we gather online, I pray that this is a meaningful time for you. For those of you who were new with us at Oak Hill, whether in the sanctuary or worshiping online recently, I extend to you a special welcome. I'm so glad you've chosen to be with us today, and I pray this time is a blessing for you. As we gather in the sanctuary, I ask that you continue to wear a mask out of love for those who are not yet vaccinated and continuing to follow public health guidance. We're asking for everyone to wear a mask in the sanctuary that covers both the nose and the mouth. I let you know that our reopening team is looking at when we can move to our next stage of reopening, and we hope to be able to share some things with you in the very near future. As we come into this place this morning, we come to worship the living God. We come to worship the God who has come into this world in Christ Jesus, the God who calls us into relationship with God and with one another. I invite you, if you are in the sanctuary, to stand with me as you are able, and either using the words on the screen or the hymnal, would you join and lift your voices to God? Will you stand as you are able?
Holy, holy, holy Lord. Please join with me as we pray. O holy God, we come to you in the beauty of this June day, and we are grateful. The warmth of summer and the bounty of your earth stirs around us, and we are grateful. On this Father's Day, we share the love of family and friends, and the family and friendship that is our church, and we are grateful. You know, gracious God, that our relationships with our fathers can be complicated. For some of us, our Father's love is like your love, O God, deep and wide, strong and constant. And we give you thanks for their protective, guiding, affirming love. For others of us, our dads were never present or were a negative presence in our lives. And we've needed your abiding love, O God, to show us the way. Thank you for bringing men into our lives who've acted as father substitutes, those teachers and coaches, neighbors and friends and family members who've filled the empty spaces our fathers left behind. Those father substitutes have truly been a gift of your compassion and kindness. And we honor them along with our fathers and grandfathers on this Father's Day as we pause for a moment of silence to lift their names up to you. Loving God, we thank you that you have shown us how important it is to follow your example as we grow in faith. Thank you for your mercy, despite our frequent waywardness. Forgive what lies behind us and turn our hearts and hands to what is ahead. Strengthen us to stand up against the challenges of this world, honoring your name and trusting your grace, and grant us courage to follow the truth you revealed to us. For we pray in the name of Jesus, who taught his followers to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now I'd like to invite the children to come forward for a time with Miss Jennifer. Gather around your screens as well for a great time with her today. Pastor Stevens being the cheerleader over here. Come on.
Good morning, guys. Myra, I'm loving the hat. Okay, how about if you girls come to this side too? Oh, it's your, from when you were a baby? Oh, it was her baby hat, guys. So today is Father's Day, and I want to tell you about someone that was not my father, okay? But he's very special to me. Don, would you show the picture? Can you guys see that picture? So that is Mel and Tommy Bradburn. They're the parents of my best friend, Tara. Now, the Bradburns moved back to Liberty, my hometown, in the fifth grade, so Tara and I have been great friends since fifth grade. And growing up, I spent a lot of time at their house. Many hours. Watching TV, watching golf or football games or movies. I spent a lot of time with them. And when I was a kid, I was very quiet. And Daddy Mel would say, he would look at me and say, Jenny, we're trying to watch a movie. You're going to have to be quiet. You're talking too much. When I hadn't said a single word. But growing up, I spent a lot of time over there. And I spent many hours at their dining room table crying because Daddy Mel was trying to teach me algebra. He was an algebra teacher, and math is not one of my strong suits. And so I would cry, and he would always be patient with me. And he treated me a lot like his own daughters. He had dreams for me. He had expectations of me. He encouraged me to try new things. He encouraged me to always work hard and to be proud of the job that I had done. And he would raise his voice with me when I needed it, and he would give me a tight hug when I needed that too. And God puts special people in our lives to help us to grow up, people to help raise us to be responsible and respectful and to do great things. And that's who Daddy Mel is to me. He's one of those special people that God has put in my life to help me grow up. So if you guys would join with me in a prayer. Thank you, God, for all the special men that you put in our lives. Help them to continue to guide us and mold us and always love us. In your name we pray. Amen. Now, if you guys will go and sit back with your parents.
Fair in the wrong. God reigns, let the earth be
Amen. Thank you for sharing, Jillian. As I have come to Oak Hill, it's been almost a year, although it seems like 50. One of the things that I hope that we're sharing every week is sharing with you how this congregation is in ministry. How is this church reaching out and sharing the love of God in Christ with others? And more importantly, how is that touching people's lives? This morning, Alana Ayler is going to share with you a little bit about Stephen Ministry. It's a ministry named after a guy in the Bible, not this new pastor here. And it's a ministry of listening. Now, we can't share with you how it's touching people's lives because that's confidential. But we can share a little bit what it's about. So, Alana, would you share with us a little bit about Stephen Ministry?
Thank you. Hi, as Stephen said, I'm Alana Ayler. I'm one of the leaders of Stephen Ministry. I'd like to share with you one of the quiet ministries of our church. We hear about the food ministries and all those others. This is a quiet ministry of our church. Since 1998, we've had Stephen Ministry here at Oak Hill. Stephen Ministry is one-on-one ministry that offers Christian love and fellowship as you walk through a difficult time in your life. We are trained to listen and to offer you comfort through our presence and a confidentiality that you can trust. As Stephen ministers, we pray with you and for you. We offer scripture and devotionals to help you as you navigate a difficult situation in your life. If you experience the loss of a loved one, we'll send you a series of books over the course of the first year to help you process your grief. Over the years, several folks have commented as to how Stephen Ministry has helped them survive heart-rending crisis and created lasting friendships. Recently, we commissioned two new leaders to our Stephen Ministry team. They are Nancy Sally and Susan McBride. They join Nancy Goodhue and myself as leaders. We are here to serve you. This is our group. We are here to serve you. If you would like to join our team as a Stephen Minister, we'd love to visit with you. If you need or want someone to listen to you and pray with you after a service or to navigate a life-altering situation, please reach out to us. Just look for one of us wearing a blue badge or put a note in the attendance card or contact the church office and we'll be there for you. There are information brochures at the information desk.
Hi, I'm
and now
John
here's
Nelson.
John.
I have been a member of Oak Hill UMC since 95. I went through, and I've been a Stephen Minister since 98. I was in the first group that was trained to be a Stephen Minister at this church. And my experience has been one of wonder, of awe, in the way that God works through us as Stephen Ministers to help those who are in crisis. It's been a wonderful blessing and a gift for me, but I also know that there's that great love of Christ that comes through this ministry that helps others who are going through crisis, hard times, and just need somebody to listen to. And I feel very privileged to be a part, to have been a part of that for the last, 20 plus years.
Thank you, John. If you need us, we are here to serve you. Please reach out to us. Thank you.
Thank you, Alana. As we learn about the mission and ministry of this church and how God is working through this church to touch people's lives, I hope that spawns in you a sense of gratitude for the way God is working in and through this church. And I also hope that that gratitude within you also spawns generosity. You see, we worship a generous God. I don't know if you've ever read that the passage from John 3:16. It says, "For God so loved the world that he gave." Just stop right there. God gave. We worship a God who is generous. We worship a God who gives of God's very self out of love. And God calls us in turn to live as generous people, offering our lives and our talents and our resources for God's work in this world. The offering is an opportunity for us to do that, my friend. Whether you give online by going to our church website, or through texting the number on the screen, or through writing a check and leaving it in the offering plate in the back of our sanctuary, know that your generosity is patterning your life after Christ. It is patterning your life after God, a God who is generous. I thank you for your generosity. This morning, I invite you to do a couple of things. One, if in your bulletin, there is a little a registration card. If you would fill out your contact information with that, and let me tell you how we will use that. If you are new to Oak Hill, we are going to follow up with you as quickly. We will follow up with you with your contact information. If you're a longtime Oak Hiller, we're going to use that information. We're going to use what you have filled out on that card, and we're going to be checking in. Because if you're gone from this place for a period of time, any of you been gone for about a year? We're going to be following up with you and checking in and making sure that you're okay. So if you would fill out that information, we have offering plates in the back of the sanctuary, and place those in there. Know that your generosity and know that your presence here this morning is an act of faith. Thank you. Will you pray with me? Gracious and eternal God, we pray that you open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit. Take our hands and use them. Take our lips and move them. And take our hearts and set them afire with your unending love. Through Christ's most holy name we pray. Amen. A few months ago, as we began to see light at the end of the proverbial tunnel, Pastor Laura and I had a conversation with one another about what we needed to be doing in worship, and particularly in the sermons during this season. I know that many of us are ready to put this whole last 15 months behind us and pretend like it never happened before, and hope that it never does again. But to skip over this time and not to look back on and reflect on it is in fact to miss an opportunity. You see, if we are willing to reflect over this last period of time, we may be able to learn some things about life and about ourselves that can help us live more fully and faithfully as we move into the future. So for the last few weeks, Pastor Laura and I have been asking us to look for the gifts, to look for the blessings, and treasure the gifts of this last period of time. So we've looked at things like recognizing the importance of community and the value of every person, including those that we often overlook. Last week, Pastor Laura spoke about the importance of rest. This morning, I want us to reflect, since it's Father's Day, reflect on the importance of family. Now, in order to do that, I wanted to find a really good scripture passage that would help us think about it. And so I went looking through the Bible for that perfect passage, something that said, our families are a wonderful gift from God, treasure them. Unfortunately, there's nothing like that in the Bible. The Bible, by the way, doesn't have a whole lot of positive images of family. The best one I could come up with was from Hosea, when Hosea marries a prostitute, and every time she goes off to her former clients, he would go off and faithfully and lovingly bring her back home. Hosea says that's like our relationship with God, that God constantly goes out to draw us back home when we wander off. But I figured that was not the best passage to use this particular Sunday. I was scratching my head and raised the question, and Jillian, our music director, suggested a story that's very familiar. And as she brought it up, I realized that this passage, I think, reflects something of what we've been going through for the last 15 months. So as I read this what may be familiar story, I invite you to listen for how it connects with life during COVID. Listen for the word of God. Then Jesus said, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the share of the property that will belong to me.' So he divided his property between them. A few days later, the younger son gathered all he had and traveled to a distant country, and there he squandered his property in dissolute living. When he had spent everything, a severe famine took place throughout that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. He would gladly have filled himself with the pods that the pigs were eating, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, 'How many of my father's hired hands have bread enough and to spare? But here I am, dying of hunger. I will get up and I will go to my father and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands.' So he set off and went to his father. But while he was still far off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. He ran and put his arms around him and kissed him. Then the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his slaves, 'Quickly, bring out a robe, the best one, and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet, and get the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and celebrate, for this son of mine was dead and is alive. He was lost and is found.' And they began to celebrate. Now his elder son was in the field, and when he came and approached the house, he heard music and dancing. He called one of the slaves and asked what was going on. He replied, 'Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fatted calf because he got him back safe and sound.' Then he became angry and refused to go in. His father came out and began to plead with him, but he answered his father, 'Listen, for all these years I have been working like a slave for you, and I have never disobeyed your command. Yet you have never given me even a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came back, who has devoured your property with prostitutes and killed the fatted calf, you killed the fatted calf for him.' Then the father said to him, 'Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. But I had to celebrate and rejoice, because this brother of yours was dead and has come to life. He was lost and has been found.'" The word of God for us, the people of God. Now, we often refer to this story as the story of the prodigal son. And we interpret it as an allegory. An allegory is a story in which everything stands for something else. And when we read this story as an allegory, we put ourselves and God in different positions. We might say that God is like the father, and we are like the children, either the one who went off or the one who stayed behind. And it's perfectly acceptable to read this story as an allegory. But Jesus didn't say, "I'm going to tell you an allegory." Jesus said, "Listen to a story. Once upon a time, there was a father who had two sons." Jesus tells us a story about family. And this story about family, we might be able to find a connection with our own lives in this world today. There was the son who went far off to a far country and was separated from his father and from his family. Show of hands, how many of you have been separated from family over the course of this last year? No, raise them if you've been separated from family. That is a reality that most of us have endured over this last 15 months. In some way, shape, or form, we have been separated from people who were dear to us. I have a friend who had a grandbaby in May of 2020. Mama, baby, and daddy are doing fine, but they're in Maine, and she has still has not gotten to see his grandchild. They have Zoomed, they have FaceTimed, but he has not gotten to hold his grandchild in his arms. How has it been being separated from family? Kind of stunk? Some of us have been like the father and the older son, that we have had all sorts of family time with one another, and we have not particularly been enjoying it. Anybody been stuck at home with family at some time over these last 15 months? I have heard from more than one mom, more than one dad, and more than one child that they've had a little too much family together this time. And every once in a while, someone in the family gets stressed. It has not been a fun season in life. What's the gift in it? What's the gift here? I know some of you may hear that question and say, Stephen, are you nuts? I have been stuck at home with my parents for 15 months. I didn't get to go to my niece's wedding. What's the gift here? That's just a silly question. But I don't think it is a silly question. I actually got the question from Mother Teresa. For those of you unfamiliar with Mother Teresa, she won the Nobel Peace Prize for her work among the poorest of poor of the poor in Calcutta, India. And one day, one of Mother Teresa's fellow sisters in her order had missed a train and was complaining about it, complaining about how all of her plans had been ruined and everything was messed up. And Mother Teresa asked her that question. She said, what's the gift here? Instead of complaining about it, instead of focusing on everything that was wrong, instead of trying to blame God for everything that went wrong, to look for the goodness, to look for the blessings, what's the gift here? In our families, being separated or together for these last 15 months, what's the gift in that? What is the blessing? Now, I realize as a pastor that anytime I bring up anything to do with family, for some people that gets uncomfortable. We expect to have perfect families, and many of us do not have them. We expect our families, many of them, to be picture perfect. This is a picture of my family from Thanksgiving 2 years ago. Don't we look wonderful and sweet? We expect all of our family to be on their best behavior all the time, and it would be wonderful if they were. Unfortunately, this is what the family often looks like. We end up being a great big mess. And people misbehave and mistreat one another, and it's just not always fun. And sometimes families can be unhealthy. My wife works for a place in San Antonio for moms and their kids who have escaped horrible situations in life. I know, family is not always a blessing. But I also believe in my heart of hearts that our families are crucial in our lives. You see, whether it was intentionally or not, our families have shaped who we are. They have shaped the type of people that we become. And no matter how far apart we are geographically, our families continue to influence us. Their dynamics and emotions can touch our lives. Families can be a wonderful blessing. They also know all the buttons that they can push to get us to respond to them. But deep down, our families can be a place of love and resilience and places of respect and care. And no matter where we are in life, they continue to shape us. And as I listened to this story that Jillian suggested, I began to recognize that I have been living this story of the prodigal son for the last year. And you may have too. You see, my wife and I, we have two sons. We have an older son and we have a younger son. Our older son graduated from college in the midst of this mess and moved into our rental house in Austin. Woohoo! Thank goodness he has a job working for a company in California from our rental house here in Austin. I know he does not want to be living with us. That's just being honest. And I have read statistics that during COVID, over 50% of young adults in their 20s are living at home with their parents. So he's just following a national trend. But he would rather be living anywhere than it at home with his parents. Yes, Mary?
Yeah.
But you know, even in the midst of that, my older son, having him at home, there's been a gift there. I have gotten to spend time with my child that I never, ever would have gotten to spend. Do me a favor, take out your bulletin. Do you have bulletins here? And grab a pen. Grab a pen. I want you to think just for a moment and write down on your bulletin, if you have been at home with family over the last year, what are some of the gifts in that? What are some of the blessings of being at home? Getting to take walks with your family, or going on bike rides with one another, snuggling up on the sofa and watching movies with one another. What are some of the gifts? What are some of the blessings of family togetherness time that you've had over this last year? One of the blessings for me is having dinner every night with my 23-year-old son. Now, we have it at 9 o'clock at night because he's working California time. But unless COVID would have happened, I never, ever would have had that time with my son, because he'd be living somewhere else. What are some of the blessings for you? What are some of the gifts of this family time? Write them down on your bulletin. Now, we've also had people who have been like the younger child and his father. We have been separated. We have not been with people we love. Our younger son has been off at college in Houston. And until everyone in our family got vaccinated, we saw him one time at Christmas. That was after we made him quarantine for 2 weeks so that he wouldn't get my mom sick. Now, we see my mom every week, but I have not seen my siblings or their kids since that lovely picture taken Thanksgiving almost 2 years ago. And being absent, not being with those people, if we will use it as an opportunity, we can recognize what it is about those people that are important. So take your bulletin, and if you have not been able to be with family over this last year, what are some of the things that you have missed? What are some of the important things for you that you have missed in being with those people? Gatherings for birthdays and anniversaries, checking in on one another, going to a wedding, or supporting one another when there is an illness or a death. What are some of those things that you have missed about those people in your lives? I have missed just being able to spend time with those people. Now take your list of those things that you were able to treasure when you were with people. And take your list of those things that you missed about them when you were separated. You see, those are actually gifts. Those are actually blessings. The time that you had that you may not have thought about was a blessing. And what you missed in those people, those are things that you treasure about them. Hold on to those and let that shape you as you move forward. One of the people who has been most influential in my life is a man by the name of Edwin Friedman. He was a Jewish rabbi and a family therapist. And Friedman used to say this. He said, "Don't let your pain go to waste. Don't let your pain go to waste. Use it as an opportunity to learn. Use it as an opportunity to grow. Don't let the pain of these last 15 months go to waste. Help it teach you to treasure the blessings in your life. Because if we will let it, God can use these last 15 months to remind us about what is truly important in our lives. Remember the blessings of time with those you love. Remember the importance of those people in your life from whom you have been separated. And then listen to what Rabbi Jesus teaches us. Rabbi Jesus teaches us to treasure the people, to gather around the table, to celebrate with one another, that what was lost has now been found. Amen. Will you pray with me? Most holy and gracious God, you have blessed our lives in so many ways. And you bless our lives with the gift of family. Sometimes we appreciate them so much and the way they touch and bless our lives. And sometimes they can be incredibly frustrating. Yet, O Lord, our families are people who love us and shape us. And we pray that you help us to be able to treasure the gift of them, especially the gifts that we have experienced over this last year, that as we step into this future, we might treasure them even more, and that we might live more fully and faithfully as the people you have created us to be. We lift our prayers through Christ's most holy name. And all God's people say, Amen. Amen. Now I invite you, if you're in the sanctuary, to stand with me as you are able. If you are watching online, if you will join and lift your voice to God, and let us join with our musicians and lift our praise to God, singing together. Thank you. I send you out, I want to let you know about three things going on in the life of the church. The first two are ways to help you connect. As a church, one of the things that I think we recognize is crucial is the need to be connected with one another and the need for community. So next week, our teenagers are going to go, and they're going to go rock climbing. They're going to go to rocking out in the evening and just have fun playing and climbing and being and hanging out with one another. Angie Bragg is here somewhere this morning, and she's back at the computer monitoring being a Facebook host. She has information about that. You can also visit with Vicky out at the connection table outside. And then next Sunday evening, about the same time, teenagers are going to be climbing rocks. We're also going to have a picnic here at the church. Just a time for us to be able to come together and be with one another after a long year of being separated. Our worship team is putting this on. I've been on vacation, so I don't have all the details. I think it's going to be bring your picnic food, and we'll have ice cream and music here. And just be together, because it's been a long time of being separated. And so we want to be providing opportunities for you to be gathering together as a community. And finally, I want to let you know about a change that's going to be happening at Oak Hill. Pastor Laura has been part of the clergy team at Oak Hill for 4 years. 4 years. And when we had some pastoral transitions at the end of 2019, Pastor Laura went from a very part-time position to working almost full-time. And as we prepare to receive two new pastors coming in the middle of July, Pastor Laura is going to do a change in her position, and she's initially going to move back to working about a quarter time, doing visitation, particularly of our people who are homebound, and helping in a transition to a new pastoral leadership team. And then probably toward the end of October, then she's going to transition out of her pastoral role here at Oak Hill, and she's going to become retired again. And spend time with her grandkids and her kids, and antiquing, I think, is one of the things she said. So I want to let you know that transition is going to be happening, and I have to let you know how thankful I am to Pastor Laura. This has been like the weirdest year for me coming into a new place, and it has been a blessing to be in ministry with her. She has helped me know a lot about this church. She's also told me where the landmines are. And so thank you, Laura, for your service here, and we will continue serving together. So we're going to go to the back of the sanctuary. You're not having to say goodbye to her yet, but just know that's going on. So my friends, here's my invitation to you. I invite you, wherever you are in your own spiritual journey, to take another step. If you sense that God is calling you to something in life, to a deeper relationship with God, to do something in particular, I invite you to respond to God's call in your life. And this week, as we celebrate Father's Day, I also invite you to recognize the importance of your family. Those people who have loved you and blessed you and helped make you who you are. Remember them. Treasure them. Whether you have been at home together for the last year or whether you've been separated, remember those blessings and treasure them. And let them shape you to live as the person God has created you to be. Go in the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.